This is the heart of a fetus. It's the most primitive form of the human heart. It's a tube. The heart of all human beings develops from this tube. The heart itself is a blood vessel. It's called the heart tube. Don't look at it as a tube. But this tube stretches, twists, and expands. When the fetus is about 22 days old, it will start to beat. This is the first time it beats. And that's when it begins its long journey of over 2 billion heartbeats in its life. On the 24th day, the blood in the fetus starts to circulate through this tube. But at this time, the blood inside the tube is flowing without direction. It's like a tidal wave. At this time, the heart is at its busiest. It's working overtime every day. And after a month, the embryo's heart tube. It starts to form the atrial and ventricular septum. The blood flow inside the heart slowly begins to have a direction. Into a unidirectional flow. The heart looks like it's in shape on the outside. But inside, it wasn't working yet. Finally, in the second month, the inside of the heart starts to split into four chambers. The heart is now taking shape from the inside out. By the fourth month, the fetal heart is almost complete. The heart is beating vigorously. It can reach about 140 beats a minute. And that's when his heart rate starts to hit the brakes. But it's a very long break. It takes years. When a child reaches the age of 5, his heart has the neurological characteristics of an adult and starts to mature around 10 years old. That's when his heart rate finally slows down. At this time, the heart beats about 70 to 80 times a minute, just like an adult's, and then begins his long life.
What would happen if water were continuously compressed? First, you would need an abundant supply of water and an extremely powerful pressure device. When you increase the pressure on water to about 10,000 atmospheres, the hydrogen-oxygen bonds within water molecules break, and it turns into a solid crystal. However, this crystal is not ice. It's a polymer of hydrogen and oxygen atoms. As you reach around 40 million atmospheres, water starts to exhibit metallic properties, forming metallic hydrogen. Possessing this substance could make you the richest person in the world. But at around 2 billion atmospheres, you need to be cautious because hydrogen atoms will begin nuclear fusion. Their atomic nuclei combine to form a new substance, helium. You would observe a massive expansion of the material in your container during this process, releasing an enormous amount of energy capable of destroying a city. So, you'd also need a super strong container to contain it. Continuing to add pressure and oxygen, the new substance helium would fuse into carbon, carbon would fuse into oxygen, and so on. When your pressure exceeds 8 times the pressure at the core of a collapsing sun, you'd reach the end product of nuclear fusion. If you still don't intend to stop, the electrons of iron atoms will attempt to resist your efforts. Continuing to add pressure, iron electrons would escape into the interior of atomic nuclei, binding with protons, positively charged particles, to form neutrons. At this point, you would have a neutron star. Do you know what happens if you continue to increase the pressure on a neutron star?
Did you know that honeybees die after they sting you? Bees have barbed stingers, so when a bee stings something that has thick skin, mostly mammals, it gets stuck, unlike hornets, which can sting multiple times without getting stuck. Once the bee stings and gets stuck, it tries to escape, which results in the barbed stinger being ripped away from the bee's body, along with part of the bee's abdomen, digestive tract, and venom sac. Unfortunately, this rupture is fatal, resulting in its death in a matter of hours. The bee's self-sacrifice is the price to pay, in order to protect the colony and ensure the survival of the hive. Bee stingers are a modified ovipositor, a structure used by female bees to lay eggs. However, in honeybees and other social bees, the stinger has evolved into a defensive tool that can inject venom to respond against threats. They also release alarm pheromones that alert other worker bees to attack the intruder collectively. This chicken can stabilize its head despite being moved around, the same as this hawk. When you shake and nod your head, your eyes naturally stabilize the image in front of you, and birds use this approach as well. They are capable of making micro-adjustments in their eyes to maintain a clear line of vision even when their bodies are in motion, and this is called gaze stabilization. Birds do this in a much more complex way, since many birds zip through trees and dive bomb prey at high speed, and this adaptation helps birds stream high-resolution visuals when moving quickly through complex terrain. They keep their heads absolutely horizontal at all costs, that way they can focus and have the most reliable information while doing crazy maneuvers. They can do this, thanks in part to a large number of vertebrae, with strong and flexible neck muscles, which help them to hold their heads in place, even when their bodies are in motion.
If we replace cremation with ice burial, where the body is instantly frozen and shattered at 196 degrees Celsius using liquid nitrogen, would you accept it? Ice burial, as intricate as it sounds, is essentially about rapidly freezing the body at 196 degrees C, turning it into a crystal. Then, using intense ultrasonic technology, the body is quickly shattered. This process takes only about a minute. The shattered human tissue is then transported to a container specifically designed to dry objects, where the final drying and sublimation occur in a vacuum environment. It's understood that this process significantly reduces the body's weight and volume. A 120-pound individual, after drying, would weigh only about 30 pounds. After this, the ashes and teeth are separated. The ice burial device quickly separates the deceased's ashes and metallic substances. The teeth are given to the family, while the ashes are placed in small boxes made from starch, potatoes, and corn. They are then buried in pits about 50 to 100 centimeters deep. Within 6 months, they will completely turn to dust. In fact, ice burial has been used by the Eskimos of North America for centuries. Compared to sky burials, water burials, and cremation, Eskimos, who spend their lives in icy environments as cold as 50 degrees C, would dig ice pits in advance when they felt their end was near and seal themselves in. A few days later, their offspring would open the ice pit, allowing the soul to be reborn. So, compared to cremation, would you accept ice burial? If all the oxygen on Earth were to disappear for 5 seconds, how long could humanity survive, and would the world be destroyed? The answer is yes. In the first second after the disappearance of oxygen, every structure built using concrete would crumble. This is because oxygen is a critical binding agent in concrete, and without it, our houses and skyscrapers would instantly turn to rubble. After 2 seconds, the ozone layer that shields Earth from harmful ultraviolet radiation would vanish completely. Walking down the street, you'd be severely sunburned. After 3 seconds, Earth's atmospheric pressure would dramatically change because we lose 21% of the air pressure. Human eardrums wouldn't have time to adapt, and they would explode, causing deafness. Even if someone were to shout at you, you wouldn't hear a thing. After 4 seconds, fires would cease to exist, making car engines inoperable. All planes would plummet from the sky, and all cars would come to a halt. The entire world would descend into chaos. After 5 seconds, as the Earth's crust contains 45% oxygen, it would collapse entirely. Under the influence of pressure and gravity, everything on land, including humanity, would plummet deep into the Earth's core. The world would be destroyed. Although it only took a brief 5 seconds for oxygen to disappear, it led to the eradication of everything. This underscores just how precious the oxygen that surrounds us truly is. Do you know how exactly is invisibility achieved? The simplest method is through a combination of 4 mirrors arranged in such a way that light passes through them, undergoing 4 reflections. Each subsequent mirror reflects the image from the previous mirror, making it appear as if the object is truly invisible when it's hidden between the mirrors. Additionally, convex lenses can also achieve invisibility by distorting the light that passes through them. When we compress convex lenses and continually increase their quantity, a magical effect occurs. However, there are some clear drawbacks to this method. While it works well for vertically oriented objects, it becomes ineffective when rotated horizontally. Furthermore, as the distance decreases, the invisibility effect significantly weakens. There's another interesting method for achieving invisibility. It involves placing projectors and cameras in front and behind an object. The camera captures the scene, which is then projected onto the object's surface by the projector. When viewed from the front, the invisibility effect is quite effective. What are your thoughts on this? This method can also be seen in movies, where background scenes are projected onto a screen to create an invisibility effect. At the same time, it scans the observer's eyes to adjust the image in real time. However, when there are more than two observers, this invisibility method is easily exposed. What would be the first thing you'd do if you could turn invisible?